Thank you, Mike. And thank you all for coming today and inviting me to speak, tell you about what we do. It's a pleasure. I've been, as Mike said, with Laserfiche for 30 years. We started as a technology pioneer, envisioning many of the technologies that we take for granted today, and heralding the advent of the paperless office. From modest beginnings, we have become the world's largest private enterprise content management company. ECM is a broad term, but we at Laserfiche like to think that our software powers organizations to take control of information and business processes. It provides automation and removes cumbersome manual tasks. Through document management and business process automation tools, we enable workers to work smarter, faster, and better. We began as a software consulting company with a handful of talented programmers in Torrance in the early 1980s. One of our clients, American Honda, was faced with a product liability lawsuit involving motorcycles. It asked us to design a litigation support package to manage the hundreds of thousands of pages in evidence. Our task was to develop a software package for use by paralegals to code each document to be managed from discovery through trial by Honda attorneys. It occurred to us at that time that if we were able to extract all of the text from the pages and index that text, it would allow the lawyers to search the repository by any word or phrase. Then we'd be offering a powerful solution. That was the genesis of Laserfiche today. Our mission was to extract information from paper and put it into the hands and minds of knowledge workers. It was a tough job to develop and market the product, especially with the high cost of storage devices and other necessary components then. But through perseverance and determination, today we are about 350 people, headquartered in Long Beach, with offices in Washington, D.C., Toronto, Mexico, London, Hong Kong, Shanghai, and Texas. We sell through a channel of about 500 value-added resellers and solution providers. Our goals are to make the best ECM software on the planet, make our partners profitable, and ensure that our users are ecstatically happy. We believe that money is a byproduct of a job well done. And if we succeed in our goals, we will be flush with capital. At present, we're doing very well. We are debt-free, continue to grow in headcount, as well as user licenses. We're constructing new, massive facilities in Long Beach, all the while generating a very healthy cash flow. Over the years, competitors have entered the market who view the space differently. With rare exception, the majority of their growth is attempted through mergers and acquisitions rather than product development. We view the process of company evaluations and purchase financing options as distractions from software engineering. Xerox, for example, is in the news for debt repurchase and exchange rather than announcement of enhancements to its ECM product offerings. By comparison, yesterday we were in the news for a 520,000 user sale to Texas A&M University. During our history, we've seen competing companies come and go. That's why we don't pay them much attention. We remain committed to our original vision, to make great software products that enable productivity, efficiency, and that people love to use. We are fiercely loyal to our employees, customers, and partners, as they are to us. Our loyalty is embodied by a commitment to their success, growth, and profitability, respectively. As we are an engineering company, we keep a very keen eye on the technology landscape and marketecture trends. How's that for coining a new word? Marketecture. For example, digital transformation is currently a buzzword in the business technology world. We took a hard look at what digital transformation really means for our users, going beyond jargon and buzzwords and looking at users' necessary functionality and useful features. Then we set about incorporating that functionality and features into our software. Last month, at our annual conference in Long Beach, we announced to over 3,000 attendees the Laserfiche Digital Transformation Model, an innovative, progressive process for all of our users, regardless of whether they have just purchased our software or been using it for 30 years. The Laserfiche Digital Transformation Model is a practical assessment tool that provides users with a five-phase roadmap based on expertise, experience, and best practices found in the Laserfiche ecosystem. The first phase begins where Laserfiche got its start, in document imaging. Users in this phase are essentially creating an electronic file cabinet by converting from paper to digital documents. Laserfiche built-in functionality includes optical character recognition and full-text search across the entire repository, metadata, and electronic folders, among other features. The software has a very robust back end, so its performance always remains peak regardless of the repository's size. I think that our user with the largest repository is the Government of Mexico Department of Immigration, with over 400 million images. It's been a user since roughly 2005. I think this phase satisfies their needs. The second phase is entered when users become familiar with working with information as images and to utilize its modern information organization and management tools. Document duplication and cross-referencing, long the mainstay of librarians, are no longer necessary as users can easily manage documents in a secure central location. Documents from electronic application packages, including Microsoft Office Suite, are also easily incorporated into this phase. The third phase is actually where many of our users find themselves today: automating manual business processes using electronic forms. This represents a quantum leap from paper-based forms processes. Forms such as online purchasing, information requests, new account openings, purchase orders, travel requests, and expense reports can all originate electronically. Paper is entirely removed from these processes, and manual tasks are eliminated, enabling staff to focus instead on strategic decision making. The fourth stage is to streamline these processes. By implementing automated workflow, efficiency within departments and across organizations can be dramatically increased. This gives management more visibility into operations and increases accountability, transparency, and compliance with applicable laws and regulations. The fifth and final stage is the transformation process. This is achieved by leveraging predictive and diagnostic analytics to determine and target inefficiencies within processes and gain insight into possible solutions. Examples in the corporate world would include bottlenecks in the purchase order approval process, or in higher education, predicting outcomes in student graduation rates. This will enable managers to fly by precision instruments rather than sight. This is particularly important, for as one advances in management, the less visibility he or she has into corporate or organizational operations. We are still developing the tools for this phase. Our goal is to have it completed by the end of this year. In 2014, we launched our Laserfiche Cloud initiative by committing all further development of our software suite to be server-based. This allows ready porting to the cloud and offers easy deployment and maintenance of our on-premise product line. In 2015, we began sales of our software as a service or cloud model. Although it doesn't include at this time all of the features of our on-premise offerings, it will by the end of 2017. And it now satisfies the full needs of many of our users. We currently have about 40 accounts on the cloud and is growing very rapidly. We will continue both product lines indefinitely because each offers technical and business advantages to different markets with different needs and budgetary requirements. In a nutshell, that's who we are and what we do. Our corporate culture is collaborative, cooperative, and nurturing. We have many extracurricular activities, including daily catered lunches, yoga, golf, running, and my favorite, the sailing team. This year, we are entering the Flying Fish into the Transpac 2017 race from Long Beach to Hawaii. We hope to be competitive. Yes. Yes, I'm going too. We are careful in our hiring and treat our staff and customers well. Together, we put the content into enterprise content management. Thank you. I'd be glad to take any questions.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you so much for sharing an expose, a detailed expose of what your organization does and how it can provide potential solutions for customers. We're going to open up to Q&A now. If you guys have questions, please share them. Raise your hand. John will walk around with the mic, and he'll get your question addressed. Please save comments and stories for after the event is over. Will you be hanging out with us just a little bit in the event that people?
Okay, absolutely.
Cool. Absolutely. So questions now, comments later. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that overview. Interesting history and the changes enabled by technology. Question about your last phase, predictive and diagnostic analytics. Can you give an example of, I mean, you may need to cloak the client, but can you give an example of how that's helped that business?
Yes. I'd like to illustrate it. With the example of purchase orders. Normally, or rather historically, they've been created on paper, and they travel from one desk to another, seeking approval at each level, ultimately landing on the CFO or financial officer's desk for payment. What we do is we create forms which will replace that paper, and will have a section on each line of the form for different signature levels indicating approval. That is, it's routed by workflow and within the software. Then the predictive analytics come in, and they'll be displayed as a dashboard with a needle representing the number of, several needles representing one, the number of successful transactions, and then two, for those that were not successful, where they were, where they got hung up. So with paper, you just have no visibility into that. But with forms and workflow of Laserfiche, you can see exactly at which stage or on which desk or which worker is stalling on it.
Over here, Chris.
Yes, thank you.
Hi, you are clearly a successful founder and CEO.
Thank you.
I am curious how much capital you started with and how long it took you to get from ground zero to profitability? While we're at it, your top two or three tips so I can follow that path.
Thank you. I hope you can avoid some of the bumps in the road that we experience. But we started as a custom software company. Honda, in my presentation, is an example of one of our customers. So we had a steady, by today's standards, a modest cash flow from those companies. It kept us comfortable at the time, but as we were launching and developing and launching a new product line, we went through that capital very quickly. We went through whatever reserves we had very quickly. But we were committed, so we stuck with it. there were times when senior management went several months without taking a salary. But as I say, we were committed and we continued. And we learned along the way. We started out as an engineering company, a software engineering company. And we knew nothing about marketing. We just developed this great product, and we thought the orders would just come in. That, to our dismay, did not happen. We had to, since we're a disciplined company, picked up books. The one I would recommend for marketing of software is Crossing Crossing the
Chasm,
or his other one, Inside the Tornado. Those are good for software engineers looking to market their products. Do you know the author of that?
The next question.
Jeffrey Moore, that's it. GeoffreyMoore. That's a good book. That was where we learned how to market software, and that provided a blueprint for us. I hope that answers your question.
John, over the decades, I've consulted to Xerox and a lot of the tech firms and read both those books. Uh-huh. My question, looking at the ones that litter the out-of-business list, what did you do right? Is it the culture, the product? How have you beaten those companies?
just through perseverance. Our motto, or my motto, is through endurance we conquer. And we have exceptional engineers. Really committed engineers from Caltech and Harvey Mudd, the Pomona schools. We recruit from the best schools. We bring them to join us. We recruit them out of college, and we train them to in our culture and on the helping us develop the platforms that. We maintain. Another thing we did not do was we did not take venture capital. That I think is the caused the failure of so many companies, because then you lose your sovereignty. You lose your control of it, of the company. Then they give you about 3 to 5 years to continue, and then they step in and take over, and they just want to dress up the company, package it for resale. I would recommend you resist that. If you have an idea and dedicated people, intelligent people, first have a good product, learn how to market, and then. I think you'll meet success. Anyway, that was the route we took.
Up here, right?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Larry. You, in your fifth step, you talked about predictive ability of your software for education insofar as graduation. Can you expand on that a bit? What is it that you do with in that arena, and how does it work?
Well, it's as I mentioned, it's still in the development or conceptual stage, but a goal and a project that we're working on in conjunction with education units, universities and schools, is to predict graduation rates. Now we look to allow the educators or the technology people at universities to develop forms into which they put a lot of information, you know, such as previous education, income levels, and other attributes of the student body or the students within the student body. And then they will use that information to then determine the success or the graduation rates of the students. That's an example of how we will use it.
Good morning. My question is with regards to innovation and competitive intelligence.
I'm sorry.
Can you hear me? I'm sorry. Okay. My question is more with regards to innovation and competitive intelligence. In this day and age, it's, okay, today you have an idea, you need to get it out of the door yesterday. So how do you make sure you're ahead of the curve? How do you keep track of what's happening in the marketplace? Do you focus on innovation? Do you have a separate team focusing on competitive intelligence? Do you work with your clients on what their needs are so you can improve your software towards that?
Well, I go back to when I was in grammar school, and we used to do track and field days. And I heard a friend of my mother's talking to my friend, and she said to him, "Don't worry about those around you. Just focus on the end line and run for that. Because if you look at the others, it will distract attention." So we just focus on making good products and getting them out to people, or to users, to companies and organizations and such. And a great help to us in that is our reseller channel. When we started in the early 90s, it was just my late wife and myself selling it, and we'd fill up a truck with computers and storage devices, and you know, today we just need a notebook like that. But we used to do that, and we would drive around to whomever wanted to see it and show it to them. You know, whether it was, you know, in one or multiple vertical markets, and that's another thing we learned about vertical markets, become the big fish in as large a pond as you feel comfortable. So we realized in the early 80s that what we did well was software development. And there were a lot of computer resellers and integrators who were, they looked to the hardware and other components of the system for revenue. So we teamed up with them, we recruited them. And another thing that they could do for us was to represent us in remote or distant locations, which we would have a very difficult time getting to. So we developed a large reseller channel, and they could sell our products in a place that we couldn't reach, where there would be a local competitor. So rather than fighting with that company, we would enlist other people to help us in that effort. That was another way in which we extended our reach and increased our profile.
One more question back here.
Sure.
What makes you choose Long Beach as the place where you started the company, and what was the specificities of that community to grow, like your company?
Well, good question. I found the building, and it was it just suited our needs. We moved to Long Beach from Torrance in the year 2001, and I had been, our lease ran out that year, and in our Torrance location, and we every 5 years we would have to go for lease renewal or find a new property or something, and it would distract my attention for about a year, and. Most real estate agents were quite arrogant, and it was just a difficult process. So we looked around for a building that we could buy and then lease out to tenants. And then as we continued to grow, we wouldn't have to sign a new lease. We would just kick out the tenants. So. That's why our building was 60,000 feet, so that held us for quite a while, and that enabled us to grow also, much more so than the confinement of a 15,000 square foot facility. Now, Long Beach has advantages. In that it enables us to recruit from both Orange County and from the Santa Monica North area. So it's a convenient location. That's another reason we chose Long Beach.
Chris, do you have time for one more?
I have plenty of time.
Hi, Chris. My name is Matt Navak, and I have a question, actually two questions. One is product specific, one is business decision making. And my clients are mostly the defense industry and manufacturers, and they do have a need for content management. And the constant struggle is access control. So I'm wondering if you've tackled that issue of having your content management and corroborative tool, but then heavily restricting access to certain types of individuals. And my second question is, You started as a custom software supplier. How did you make that decision where your resources are dominated by, say, Honda, large customers wanting various features that they want versus trying to build something for a larger audience? Thank you.
Thank you. That's a very good question. I'll get to that in a moment. For aerospace and defense, we're Department of Defense or DoD 505.1 compliant, and we also have a very rigorous and complex security within the software. It's used by many defense and intelligence agencies, including the CIA and others, the FBI and the Navy, and virtually all federal government agencies. The transition from custom software house to shrink-wrapped software was a conscious one, because we wanted to get out of the custom software business. That required that for each sale, we had to do a requirement analysis, a presentation, and ultimately a sale. And then when that was made, we would then have to design and support unique installations for each customer. And we'd have to maintain a staff, or at least one dedicated person, to maintain an account such as Honda. So we wanted to get away from that. We wanted one software product that was used by everybody and could be supported by a single staff. That was one of the main reasons we developed Laserfiche.
But even once you do that, you're going to have those large customers wanting
Oh, yes. And our Laserfiche is an open architectured a software product, and it is it can be integrated with virtually any product on the market. And we have we offer an SDK which is used by resellers and is to customize and will allow them to generate revenue from that. Now the product works very well right out of the box. It will do everything that I've described here before. What resellers will be to customize and design workflows and design forms and configure the system. It can be installed with an installation wizard, just next, and it can be up and going in half an hour. Which compared to our competitors, you know, who take 6 to 18 months to become functional, marginally functional, I mean, deliver basic benefits, that is a breath of fresh air.